All right. What are you gonna do? No. Okay. No. Yeah. No. This spray is not for me.
You talked about Antarctica, of course, being and people going there and getting turned away at gunpoint. But what about, say, the early explorers? Do we get any indication that the composition is the way you've described from the early explorers who tried to get down there or tried to sail around Antarctica or anything like that?
What you just said is one of the most insanely idiotic things I have ever heard.
Yeah, the early sailors that went to the Antarctic, like James Clark and Captain Cook, they spent years trying to find an inlet into the Antarctic ice. On the Ball model, it's supposed to be only about 12,000 miles around the Antarctic ice continent, but on the Flat Earth map, it would be much bigger than that. And in reality, when you sail around it, as I said, it takes 3 or 4 years, and they weren't going in a straight line, but they were chartering 50 or 60,000 miles around as they were trying to find an inlet into the ice wall, never able to find one.
Funny how Eric doesn't mention other famous Antarctic explorers like Bellingshausen, who many credit as the first person to circumnavigate the Antarctic. He traveled from Australia to Brazil via circumnavigation of Antarctica, and that only took about 6 months. Maybe all these interviews are cutting into Eric's research.
Yeah, and you also have, and this is another quote that I pulled off your site, a guy named William Carpenter. He says, "Yes, but we can circumnavigate the South easily enough," is often said by those who don't know. The British ship Challenger recently completed the circuit of the southern region indirectly, to be sure, but she was 3 years about it and traversed nearly 69,000 miles, a stretch long enough to have taken her 6 times around the globular hypothesis.
This quote is from a turn-of-the-century Flat Earth book. Apparently, no one in the Flat Earth community bothered to check if this proof made any fucking sense before belching it all over the internet. The voyage of the HMS Challenger had nothing to do with Antarctica. In fact, they never saw the continent. Its path took the Challenger all over the world, and it did some of the most important scientific experiments of its generation.
Which is interesting because you can then visualize someone trying to get around this island they have in their head, this big island of ice, this big continent of ice, this idea they have in their head, and they're trying to get around it by just going the same direction. And if you picture it in the Flat Earth model, you can visualize how they would just be bumping into the edge all the way around until they got back to kind of their starting point, and then they'd go back up north and be like where they were.
What you talking about, Willis?
And to them, they think they went around a big continent, but they did exactly the opposite and went on the inside of a giant edge. And I thought that quote was pretty interesting.
Yeah. Another thing those early explorers found is that they were always outside of their reckoning every day as far as how far they should have traveled on their maps. So they were an average of 12 to 16 miles, sometimes as much as 29 miles out of reckoning.
I cannot figure out where Eric gets the information for his claim that explorers average 12 to 29 miles out of reckoning. I could see a ship being off course every once in a while, but every single Antarctic exploration ship being off course every time?
I know what to do. I read a book.
Lieutenant Charles Wilkes, commander of the United States Navy Exploration Expedition to the Antarctic in 1838, it's been almost 4 years going around, and he was writing in his journal how every day he was sometimes up to 20 miles in less than 18 hours out of reckoning.
I cannot verify the claims Eric is making here about Charles Wilkes. See, this is the benefit of throw shit at a wall and hope it sticks pseudoscience. Eric can list off a bunch of unsighted malarkey and still sound well informed. It's quantity over quality. He could be telling the truth, he could be misrepresenting the data, or he could be talking out of his ass. I don't know.
And so they always have to chalk it up to water currents or some sort of thing like this, but they're consistently out of their reckoning because The flat Earth, of course, is much bigger in the southern so-called hemisphere than the ball Earth would be. So the maps that they're using are all assuming the ball Earth. They're flat maps, by the way. They use, it's called plane sailing is the most common used navigation method, which is done assuming the water is a plane, as it actually is.
Sailors use plane sailing because it corrects for the globe on a map. If the world wasn't a globe, you wouldn't need to correct for it, dumbass.
The natural physics of water proves that all the surface of water on Earth is a plane, by the way, because, as you know, water will always find and maintain its own level. So if it's dammed up and then released, it will rapidly rush off in all directions until it remains level. Yet they say that we're on a big ball here, and the oceans are all convex, somehow, you know, held on to the Earth through the magical force of gravity, yet we can see with our eyes, and we know through physics.
You keep using the word.
That water maintains and always is level.
Yeah, that's a compelling point, and...
Are you serious?
It just sits there because it hasn't broken the surface tension. But watch this. A couple of drops of detergent splits up the molecules in the middle.
You did bring up earlier that the horizon always looks flat, and I think most people would say, well, that's a perspective issue. That would
ding, ding, ding.
What do we have for, Johnny?
Be the argument, the typical argument. But if you haven't seen it, people should look at it. You're right about the idea that there's people who have attached cameras to balloons, just independent people who've attached a high-def camera to a balloon, sent it up as high as they possibly could just to get that footage, because it is interesting to do. And you are right, as far high as it goes on any of these videos that I've seen, I'm a little surprised that you never see a curvature. Even thousands of feet up, you don't see that curvature. It's a little odd. You'd expect to see it.
Yeah, though sometimes you do see curvature, and it's because of using a wide-angle lens.
Right.
For instance, on the Red Bull dives that Felix Baumgartner did that everybody has seen, if you notice, the outside cameras are clearly wide-angle lens, and then there's an inside cockpit camera that isn't. And as you're watching it from the outside cameras, you'll notice that the supposed curvature of the ball Earth starts really early on, just as he's lifting off. And the exact same curvature, it stays exactly the same all the way up to the point where he's going to jump. So the curve is the same, but his altitude has risen by many, many miles. The reason the curve is the same, of course, is because it's a wide-angle lens effect. It's not actually the curve of the horizon. It just seems that way.
Right.
And that's proven by the inside camera, which, as the door opens, you can see the horizon out that inside camera. It has risen to the eye of the camera. As I said, on a ball Earth, you wouldn't open that camera and have the horizon right at eye level in front of you, no matter how big the ball was. That effect can only happen on a flat plane.
This image of the horizon, once again, you can see that I have to look down by the horizon, and this is at about eye level, and you can see the horizon looks like about 3 degrees below the actual eye level of the camera. And so I decided to, guess what? Take a picture of the actual horizon, and would you look at that? 3 degrees. You actually have to look down by about 3 degrees in order to see the horizon.
And you can see in that dive shot that the inside camera, the horizon is completely flat.
Mm-hmm.
Then it goes to the outside, and you got a huge curve. But when you're looking at some of the amateur balloon footage, some of it's lens corrected, and it's completely flat. And others, like the GoPro stuff, the horizon will fluctuate as the camera spins and tilts. The horizon will go convex and concave. But whenever it's still, it will level off at completely level, and you can see that the convex and concave the images are just a lens effect. It's obviously not the horizon shifting every 2 seconds as the camera jumps.
Yeah.
And when it's still, you can see all the way up, totally flat.
Yeah, I have a GoPro, so I'm very familiar with that fisheye lens, which, yeah, that's not going to be reliable for what we're trying to look at. And another thing about that guy who does the jump from the upper atmosphere, when he lands, he does a Masonic hand symbol. So he very well could just be another pawn in the game to create the illusion. I thought that was pretty interesting.